for industry solutions. And then with me today, I have Mike Arce. Mike.
Hey everybody, thanks for attending. I'm Mike Arce, Chief Product Officer at Moxie Health, really focused on helping in the peer and provider space and eliminating a bunch of angst and problems that exist there. So I'll be starting things off here. Dharmesh, can we go to the next slide? So we're going to be talking about claims on file. I'm sure a lot of you are aware of how claims exist today on how clearinghouses, payers, and providers work together in claims processing, but this is an ultra simplified view of what exists today with providers handling care delivery and documentation of care within EMR and other products of the sorts, and then code and create bills or claims for those visits that then get sent via an 837 transaction to the payer, typically flowing through a clearing house and taking a few days to get through that whole process to get to a health plan that is then adjudicating, paying, remitting, doing things like delivering explanations of benefits through the process. And overall, in today's states, or what we're calling the status quo here, an interesting anecdote or metric I was able to find is that 35 days in AR for most claims, or average for claims that exist in the physician practice side of the world. And those are not even specialty practices or more complicated like hospital visits. And that was pulled straight from the MGMA AR dashboard that is available to all MGMA people with an account there. So what we're going to talk about here is some of the pain points, some of the problem areas, which will then highlight areas for opportunity as we look to adopt new standards and technologies to improve how claims operate overall, and maybe in a FHIR fashion. So on the next slide, Dharmesh, please. These are just an example of challenges. I'm sure many of you have a lot of issues you've run into from either working in the industry or as a patient. When it comes to claims processing, I recently had a shoulder surgery, and even to somebody who's worked in healthcare, I've been in the industry since 2004, it's still confusing to get facility bills and physician bills and supporting staff bills and try to figure out what goes where and who's billing for what. And so some of the challenges touch patients. Obviously, there's administrative costs and administrative burden and waste that exists on all sides of the claims process, like not only the provider side, but with health plans and even the clearing houses. And then underlying a lot of that are differences or inconsistencies that exist within the tools or the different workflows that are in place to kind of make this all happen. And so wherever there's a difference or wherever there's inconsistency, we have an opportunity for failure, opportunity for just problems to happen. And because all this is going on in like a batch process that takes a few days, it just gets exacerbated and amplified each time. On to the next slide, Dharmesh, here. So when it comes to the claims process, there's a number of use cases that sit alongside just processing claims. There's the pure like submitting claims, adjudicating those claims. Often there's manual work that goes into submitting them, like in the coding process and reviewing the coding. And that's requires a lot of human effort, which is error prone. And on the adjudication side of things, there's often many delays because we have to review things and people are looking at these. And those are kind of the obvious scenarios. But when it comes to FHIR, we have more opportunities to help here. And so to throw some of the other challenging use cases out there, prior authorization, we all know is a very big problem. Providers dislike how this works. Patients dislike how this works. Payers dislike how this works. It causes a lot of delays. Care is often delayed. And treatment gets confusing or difficult because we're talking about what procedures to do and putting patients in the middle of the process to advocate for themselves. We have many opportunities to improve that by just working with better data faster. And overall, the revenue cycle is a frustrating and difficult process. And we know how many organizations work solely to help on RCM side of things. And there's large businesses built off of that. And it adds to that like $852 billion that are spent annually on the administrative side of healthcare that we could probably put to better use by providing different care or doing more research. So kind of all of this underpins the various challenges that exist in today's world, which all of those challenges, as we know, can be opportunities to improve and opportunities to make things better. So Dharmesh is going to talk next about some of those opportunities and what exists today and how we can improve.
Thank you, Mike. So if you look at, I'll start with talking about the three key claims transactions that are most widely used today in the industry. And then in context of those, we'll look at how it is done today and what is the future vision that we can implement using FHIR. And what are the purpose? What are the pain points and how can we address those pain points? So number one is eligibility verification. And this is the transaction typically executed to inquire about patients' eligibility and coverage for the insurance. And today, this eligibility and verification transaction is conducted using EDI X12 270 to 71 transaction, which is in accordance with the HIPAA compliance requirements laid down by US government CMS. Then the second transaction is around prior authorization, also for utilization management. And this transaction is essentially to request pre-approval for the healthcare services or referrals provided by a provider or hospital when a patient is admitted, but then you need to get those services or referrals pre-approved by the health plan. And so how do the provider systems or provider groups get those pre-approval? And today it is done through EDI 278 transactions, request response, and then if you need additional information, patient information, you can share it using EDI 275. And then the third set of transactions fall into claims processing. This includes submission of the claims, reimbursement, and also inquiry of claims that are in the pending state. And the EDI transactions for that are 837, 835, which is request response. And then 276, 277 are also request response. As Mike mentioned, I think all these are batch processes, and they are typically done in a batch fashion today. And all these transactions are supported through clearing houses, which sits in the middle between payer and the provider. So if you look at the eligibility verification transaction, right, I'm going to go deep into each one of these and then talk about how FHIR can be applied to modernize these transactions, and then what is the value proposition we get if we use FHIR for this, right? And then I will also touch upon some of the work that HL7.org has done in this regard, as well as some of the FHIR implementation guides. Those were published by the HL7 working groups, specifically financial working groups. So eligibility verification is the transaction to, as we talked about, right, inquire about patients' benefits and coverage information. Typically, you want to have this transaction implemented in real time. Today, there are online portals that are provided by the payers and the third party, like clearinghouses, where members can go and check for their eligibility, as well as providers can go and check for the eligibility. Sometimes you have to call the IVR for the plan, health plan, and get the information. If we modernize this and have this transaction implemented as a RESTful FHIR compliant APIs, where we can have real-time access to the benefits and coverage information along with the accumulator information like deductibles and copay, we are opening up the access to the data to the third-party applications, which is also a goal for the new CMS interoperability regulations. So this is a future state vision where the FHIR can be really, really helpful here. It would drive the cost. It would reduce the cost for such transactions. The processing of such transactions, because current transactions also involve a lot of manual processing and handling of such requests. It would improve provider, payer, and patient experience from all different perspectives. Entire ecosystem will be helpful here. And then it will also reduce the call center volume of calls that that are being processed by the by either through human agents or through IVR agents. So what is the, how do we do that, right? What is in it in the FHIR that could help us do that? So I think as part of the FHIR R4 financial model, there are two key resources, and I'm starting small, but this gets even complicated as we look at the other transaction. So the first transaction is around, you know, you want to make an eligibility request, which is basically replacement of 270, but more lighter weight, more modern transaction going in the FHIR specification, which is more interoperable, going from payer to provider to payer to request the eligibility information, and then the response comes back as a coverage eligibility response resource, which is another FHIR resource defined under the financial module of FHIR R4. Now, why would I do it, right? Because EDI 270, 271 already works, things happen through clearinghouses. Why would I FHIRize this, right? So the couple of benefits here is now you can have API level access directly to this coverage eligibility request and response workflow, which your third-party application developers, if they are building newer mobile web apps or even conversational interfaces, they could directly tap into the FHIR services provided in the middle that could basically help serve those applications and get the real-time access to this. Then the second transaction that I've looked at is the prior authorization transaction, which is basically requested for the pre-treatment for, you know, authorization from the plans. And here the healthcare service provider wants to obtain the authorization quickly, right, to avoid the delays in providing care to the members or patients. At the same time, members want a quick and timely decision so that there is no, you know, no gaps in care. I mean, sorry, no issues with the patient outcomes. And then in current state, I think this is done online, manual. Some of the documentation that is required to seek the prior authorization is needs to be submitted manually, and or fax and stuff like that, which is really slow, right? And then getting prior authorization, delays in getting prior authorization will cause further delays in providing services or care to the patient, which is not good. And there is an opportunity here to FHIR, through FHIR APIs, optimize this whole prior authorization process. And there is a separate FHIR implementation guide just talking about the prior authorization, which I'll touch upon in a minute. And then what it will drive is it will basically reduce also waste and abuse of resources on both the sides, on the provider side as well as the payer side. And it also reduces the burden, administrative burden on the payer and producer and providers, which will eventually bring down the cost for such transactions. And so today this is done using EDI 278, and 275 is used, the 275 transaction is used to send more information about the patient. It is request response, but it is done mostly in the batch form. In the newer world, there is an IG, there are three IGs, three implementation guides that's been published. It is a little bit, I mean, it is not done yet. It is still work in progress. So the CRD is coverage requirements document, which is based on the CDS hook specification. That is basically a call to make a decision whether the prior authorization is required for a given service. Once we've determined that, and this hooks up directly into the system that is used by the providers, which is electronic medical record system. If it supports CDS hooks, then it is just very seamless. There's no need to write any specific things in the middle for the providers to use the prior authorization. Then there is a documentation templates and rules IG, which is used to basically send more information to the payers that is required to make the prior authorization decision. And then the submission of those prior authorization requests, which can be processed by the payers in real time. This is where some of the AI and machine learning capabilities can be utilized to auto approve the prior authorization request, return the response as a FHIR claim inquiry or claim resource, and then additional information can be also exchanged through FHIR API. So this can modernize this transaction can help it in a long way. The third set of transactions I wanted to talk about is claims processing, and this includes submission, inquiry, adjudication, and remittance for the medical claims. Here, the opportunity is basically to improve the efficiency of the claims processing transactions as well as reduce errors. And then using NLP and the FHIR APIs, there's a lot of opportunities to reduce the time required for medical coding, which can be done automated. Today, it is manual. And then there is also a possibility of FHIRizing the claim resource so that it can be used for auto adjudication. And these are some of the EDI transactions that I've tried to map to the FHIR resources. These FHIR resources are part of the financial module. A lot of information is available already on the FHIR R4 financial module on hl7.org. Look at it, but at a very high level, I only have 3 minutes, so I'm going a little fast here. Is the financial module covers all the transactions that can be implemented for the claims processing or general revenue cycle management. And these are some of the resources that are discussed as part of the financial module. And then these are those key business activities or transactions that are mapped to the request and response FHIR resources that can be used to carry out this transaction in the FHIR world. There's a lot more work required in this area. This is still new. By no means this is going to replace the clearinghouses or the EDI traffic that is happening today, but this is the area where there is a lot of, but that area of claims processing has a lot of improvement, opportunity for improvement, and we should look into this is what I think I suggest. With that, I think I will end my presentation. If you have any questions, you can contact us, me and Mike, on Zulip chat as well as OI app. And I can take the questions now along with Mike.
There is one question on the HUA. Do you know if there is any chance that FHIR will enhance the FHIR claims resources to satisfy the available attributes on the HIPAA X12837 IP and dental?
I believe the current claim resource is already rich enough to handle the 837 data elements. But if it doesn't meet your requirements through FHIR profiling, through extension mechanism that is built into FHIR, you can certainly create and extend the claims resource. And that's where the most important part is having a very good implementation guide for real-time claims processing would help. Like we have an implementation guide that is addressing just FHIR authorization, but we still don't have an IG for real-time claims processing, which would probably address the profiling of the claim resource to meet the needs of real-time claims. Also, should we really map 837 one-on-one with claim? Because it is used in legacy format, we can take the idea, but we don't necessarily need to map each and everything if it is not used for claims processing.
The next question is, does this require EHRs and payers to build FHIR-based interfaces?
Yes, it does. So for I think there's most of the EHRs are already down that path of supporting FHIR in the EMR systems. But in addition to that, the specifications like CDS hooks and Smart on FHIR, which is part of the prior authorization service implementation guide, those specifications reduces the burden on the EMR vendors for integration and also for the providers or provider systems to basically do something that is non-standard, right? So CDS hooks is basically a trigger that can be generated directly from the EMR. To call a CDS hook service, it returns a card, and then that card could have a link to launch a Smart on FHIR app. And then that Smart on FHIR app can be used for collecting information and sending information to the payers that is required for FHIR.
Okay, thank you so much for coming to speak, and thank you everyone for attending.
Thank you.